Hi everyone, it's William Lau here. I'm a teacher of computing at the Central Foundation Boys School. And what I thought I'd do today is I would represent a conference session that I ran at the CAS conference back in February, March 2020. And a lot of people have been asking about this session on semantic waves and how this might be applicable to computing and actually a wide range of subjects. So I thought I'd share this content with you today. So these are the two questions that we're going to try and answer today, both pastorally and also academically. So why do students find certain topics or concepts so difficult to understand, and what can we do about this? And we're going to look at that in terms of different subjects. There might be more of a slant on computer science as that's and computing as that's my subject specialism, but hopefully you can apply it to your subject as well. But I think it also has a pastoral focus too. So essentially, we can look at this problem from a academic perspective to start with. Now, you can imagine a student standing on one side of a cliff with high-stakes reading on one side, and by the end of the course, on the other side, they're expected to perform high-stakes writing. And in the middle, we have this gap. And that's essentially where the teaching happens. And I feel as though at the school that I'm at, Central Foundation, we already do so much to try to help students make that gap. And I'm sure these are things which teachers do all the time as well. And what I wanted to do is I wanted to summarise all these great things that we do. And I decided to put that into a diagram, and it's a very busy diagram. It's deliberately quite busy. I've tried to encapsulate all the best practice that I see in classrooms in order to make teaching and learning successful. But despite the fact that we do all of this incredible practice, despite the fact that we do all different types of modelling, all different types of assessment, our behaviour management, retrieval practice, and questioning, even though we do all of this, there are still some gaps for some students. There's a small minority that still can't access certain material despite our best efforts. And I wondered, could semantic waves at the top here be a key missing piece of the puzzle? So hopefully I'm going to present to you a theory or perspective which you're all going to find useful. I know many teachers and support staff already use semantic waves on a daily basis, although they might not call them semantic waves. However, I think by highlighting this theory or this facet of the theory, it will make us more aware and how powerful that all of this actually is. So where does this all come from then? To understand semantic waves, is actually part of a larger theory called legitimation code theory, or LCT. And we're not going to go into all the different codes. We're going to focus mainly on semantics. And the person behind this theory is Professor Karl Maton, and he came up with this Cartesian plane. And he says that this semantic plane is relevant in a wide range of disciplines, not just in computer science or any other academic subjects from education, but also applies to engineering, to sports, law, dance, and music. And I think I've witnessed this a lot with all the incredible work that pastoral members of staff do as well. So people like our heads of year and form tutors, I think they also use this as well. So the semantic plane has two axes. Semantic gravity, which describes how concrete or abstract something is. So the more gravity you have, the greater the semantic gravity, the more concrete a concept is. And whereas when we decrease the semantic gravity, it becomes more abstract. And then secondly, we have semantic density. So how much meaning is packed into a concept or term? So where we have concepts with low semantic density, they're quite simple. Whereas where we have concepts which have high semantic density, they're a lot more complex, condensed, and there's a lot more links, interlinks between different topics. So I would say that on the left here, you'd have everyday words, or what you might call tier one words, things which are simple and easy to understand and explain to people. Words like happiness or love, you could explain that to a 7-year-old or an 8-year-old. They're fairly simple. Happiness and love might actually appear more towards the top left, because it might be something that's quite abstract to start with. And as we move to the right, terms and concepts have a lot more complexity and interconnections with other theories. So on the right side of the plane, we essentially have our academic zone, where we're aiming for all of our students to get to. And that's kind of like the gap that we saw in the previous slide. And so what I thought we'd do is I thought that we would look at some tier three words with high levels of complexity. So they're going to be very context specific, because they're tier three words. And I didn't just want to look at computing. I want to look at other subjects as well, just to put the audience at a certain level of unease, so that they would see like what it would feel like to be thrown into this, and these are kind of like the concepts which we would need to look at. So for example, in geography, this is like the zone that we're talking about, this zone here that we're trying to get all of our students to get to by the end of our course, or by the time they leave school. If we look at geography AQA GCSE paper 1, now here is a small selection of tier 3 keywords taken from the 2018 GCSE exams. Now, some of these terms are abstract and high level and general, and then some of them are more concrete and very specific. So words like, like hardwood agreements, a quarry is something that's physical, and the savannah and the tundra is something that's quite concrete, that we can show pictures of, and it's quite easy to, well, you can explain. Whereas something like glaciation is nearer to the top up here. So the concepts which are a bit more abstract, a bit more general, go at the top, and then the concepts which are a bit more specific and that we can give definitive examples are. And I think the ones that I gave was like Cori or U-shaped valley would go, they're more concrete and specific, so they get at the bottom right. Looking at some other subjects, you can see how complex our job is. So this is some from PE. And these are just a small selection of terms that you have to learn for the GCSE paper at PE. And now computer science. I didn't necessarily pick AQA or a specific example for any reason. It was just that these were readily available. Someone had already made these readily available as well. So these ones from computer science, like things like non-volatile or operating system, application layer, was a protocol. That's quite an abstract kind of concept. So that would belong somewhere close up here to the top right. And you can begin to see how complex a teacher's job is, but also how complex it is for a student. Because like a student studying just 10 GCSEs would have to know 600 of these tier 3 words. And that's not even including subjects like MFL, where the majority of words they encounter are tier 3 words, because they're completely context specific to that subject and they won't hear them anywhere else. So I thought like one activity that I gave people was to get out an exam paper or a specification, be it from the GCSE specification or A level specification, and then actually highlight all the tier three words. So your subject specific keywords that the students are highly unlikely to encounter in their daily day-to-day life and which will need explicit teaching. And I'd recommend you spend like 10 or 15 minutes doing that. Now these are readily available. So if you just go on, I teach GCSE. So if I say like, I mean, it's already preloaded because I've gotten this quite a lot. This is the previous J276. This is the specification which is just ending right now. But I would probably print this out and go through here. And you know, the tier three keywords, there are lots already. So you've got like CPU, von Neumann architecture, MAR, MDR, program counter, accumulator, ALU, CU, cache, execute maybe. I think fetch is probably not a tier three word, but execute definitely. And there's often this debate of, well, what happens if this word like fetch means different things in different contexts? So a student might be able to explain a dog fetching something, but can they actually explain the minutiae of a CPU fetching instructions from RAM and putting in the MDR, for example? And I'd recommend this is useful for all subjects because you begin to see from a novice's perspective how complex our subject is and how it might be quite challenging to teach and to learn a certain subject. So I'd just spend like 10 or 15 minutes doing that. You can pause the video and do that if you wish. But it's a very useful exercise, I think. Sure where my slides have gone. Okay. So once you've done that, what we should do next is we should consider the theory in a bit more detail. And we need to look at some of the traps that might occur when we are teaching. So what Maton states is that there's a risk in some classrooms that there is a lot of unpacking, i.e., simplifying, going from the abstract to the concrete examples without any repacking. So we take a really abstract term, say, for example, I would say that the internet is fairly abstract, or say, like, for loops or while loops or nested loops are quite abstract. And you give lots of examples and you unpack them, you simplify, and essentially you go from abstract to concrete. And that is what most good teachers do. But he says that then what a lot of teachers, or what some teachers don't do, is they don't then repack the term. And he terms these downward escalators. So what he says is that he encourages to take the content that once we've introduced what the abstract term is, and we've given lots of concrete examples, so you introduce the concept of a while loop, you go through lots of different examples of a while loop, showing how you might have, well, you would always have a condition at the top, and then you might have a very basic while loop which ends after a certain number of loops or when a certain condition has met. You might have a while loop with a counter. You might also have a while loop with an if statement so that when a certain condition is met, something happens. So those are all the very concrete examples that we should be doing so to make the abstract concrete. But then what it says is that we should then repack the content and generalize and theorize afterwards. So once we've given all these examples of while loops, or for loops, or given all these examples of, say, secondary storage devices or protocols, we then need to generalize and then need to say, okay, so when would we actually use these? So when would you actually use a while loop as opposed to for loop? When would we actually use these protocols? And in doing so, we create what he calls our semantic waves. So we take a concept, we unpack it and make it concrete, give lots of concrete examples, and then we repack it as well. And by continuously going from concrete back to abstract, from complex and simple and back, this is what it might look like in a lesson. And he says that actually, in a lesson, you would have several semantic waves. You wouldn't just have one. You could have semantic waves within a lesson, several of them within a lesson. You would have semantic waves within a unit of work as well. Now, he also says that, so this is what it might look like within a lesson. So you go from high stakes reading. This is high stakes writing, the other side of the cliff that we're trying to get to. And we're starting with these abstract terms that we have to somehow help students understand. And so we dip straight into concrete examples. Because when you've got something that's quite abstract, like binary, we need to give them lots of examples of like ones and zeros, colours, sound, and how they're represented. So we go into concrete examples, but then we repack. Then we give more concrete examples and repack. And eventually, we get to a stage where we're able to perform this high-stakes writing, which is essentially what an exam is. And it doesn't really matter what subject you're studying at GCSE and A level, you're going to need to perform some high stakes writing. And so he also identifies some other traps. So let's look at line A first of all. So he says that line A shows what happens when a teacher never unpacks. So in some classrooms, they just stay at the abstract all the time. So it's abstract, it's general and complex without any examples. But hopefully, like, even throughout this presentation, you've heard me give examples of how we might unpack the concept of using binary by using binary numbers, by showing binary addition, by colouring in pixels. These are all concrete examples of ways that you might teach binary. So colour by pixel, other things that you might do. You might actually use like binary games. So there's a binary game online. So if you just Google binary to denary game, that would be another concrete example of how you might use it. But in some classrooms, they might just stay abstract, general and complex without any examples. And I suppose we've all been there when we've observed a lesson and you're going in there as a novice. You might be observing another teacher teaching another subject and you're sat there with the students. No one really understands what's going on because the teacher hasn't actually given any complex, any concrete examples. So they've talked about glaciation, how it might be this process, but they actually haven't shown you what a glacier is or what a U-shaped valley is or what a Roche-Moutonne is. And by giving you these examples and showing pictures, videos, looking at case studies, we're giving concrete examples. And that is how we get our downward escalator, but then hopefully a semantic wave back up. He says that actually line B, you could also have a risk where you just do lots of concrete examples, but you don't link back to the general theory. So, for example, you just do lots of binary to denary conversion, or you just do lots of quadratic equations in maths, or you just do lots of, petal paragraphs in English, or you come up with like hundreds of similes whilst discussing similes, but then you never actually go back into the abstract and say, well, why do we actually use a simile? Why do we actually need to use binary numbers, or when would we even use like binary addition? So all of these things that we learn, we have to then generalize and then go back up to the abstract, say, well, the reason why we use this, the reason, what is the effect of using a simile here? What is the effect of, or why do computers actually use binary? We answer those poignant questions and we help the students understand these topics. And essentially, we help close the gap. Now, as I said earlier, I think this applies pastorally too. And I know this is a bit of a segue, but you know, you've probably realised by now that I don't really get out much. I mean, both in terms of my class classroom and my house, particularly during lockdown, but even in general. But sometimes I like stick my head out of my classroom and I hear these like incredible conversations from our directors of learning, our heads of year, and the pastoral team, like our inclusion team. Or even like at a detention, you hear a teacher explaining something. So you might hear a teacher, essentially, you might hear someone say that, you know, tell a student that you did something inappropriate or you were rude. And the student might have a really puzzled look and they might say, no, I wasn't rude or I wasn't inappropriate. So essentially then the teacher or the head of year will then give a specific example. So they're going into the concrete then and they say, well, you know, you were talking over miss or you were talking over sir and that is rude. So they've given the example, or you push someone into the classroom and that's inappropriate. So when you take a term, and for some students, they don't actually understand what that means. We say, oh, well, you were rude. And to them, they didn't think they were rude, or they didn't think what they did was inappropriate. But actually, when you give the example, it's then really hard to deny that. You're like, oh, yeah, I guess me talking whilst sir is talking or whilst miss is talking is a bit rude, isn't it? Or if someone pushed me into the classroom, I suppose, I think that was inappropriate, wasn't it? So then, you know, the teacher might turn back to the student and say, well, do you think that was appropriate or inappropriate? Or do you see how that might be considered rude? And essentially what they've done is they've told the student they were rude or inappropriate, they've given the example, and then they've brought it back to the abstract and said, you know, it obviously was a bit rude, and you should... and you're trying to get them to generalise already. So I think these semantic waves... which I mean the best practitioners are already using, are indeed really powerful, and it makes things easier for students to understand. And I think the understanding, whether it's something that's pastoral, behavioural, or in terms of subject content, by using these semantic waves, we are able to, I suppose, help students understand what is going on. So let's have a look now at what this might look like in a classroom. I tried to plot a few of the techniques, which I think I've seen in hundreds of lessons, and how we might combine these to ensure students using semantic waves. Because at the moment, I think we're still quite abstract, aren't we? And I probably need to give some concrete examples of how we use these semantic waves. So I think one way that we might take something that's quite abstract and make it more concrete is by using a simile. So you might say to maybe year 7 students or primary students that the CPU is like a brain. Now, you don't actually want them to remember that as their definition, but it helps make it a bit more concrete. You know, you can say, well, it does all the processing like the brain. And then likewise, you might give an analogy. So one thing that I talk about is a firewall. And I actually use the analogy of osmosis in biology. So those of you who remember osmosis at GCSE biology, you have this semi-permeable membrane, which only lets certain things in and out. And you have this with guard cells or stomata in plants as well, which only let certain things in or out. And that is kind of like a firewall, isn't it? Or you could say it's like a security guard or a bouncer who only lets certain things in or out. So using those analogies, and the student's like, oh, so that's what a firewall is. It's someone who only lets certain things or certain people in and out, and it's trying to detect malicious things as well. You might use a metaphor, or you might use a mnemonic. There are loads of mnemonics, and Adrienne Tuff actually has a whole book of poems that she uses, and I think I mentioned that later on as well, as a way of making abstract terms a bit more concrete. So there might be mnemonics to remember certain layers or certain protocols, and we can use those as well. I think metaphors are really useful, and this is across like all subjects now. I'm not just talking computing, but hopefully you see where I'm going with that. Other things we might do is we might tell a story, or we might go into detail on etymology as well. And I'm going to give you an example of a story right now, because I suppose this session could be as long or as short as as needs be. So let me just do a quick segue. It's kind of like an unplanned one, but it's something which I also spoke about at the CAS conference. It was another session that I did. So I'm going to pull this up now, and I'm going to tell you a story. And this is a story that I tell all my students, and it should kind of help you see how stories and etymology is really, really powerful. So I suppose we'll start at like September 2015. And September 2015 is a time when my teaching philosophy changed significantly. I had this new head teacher, and he introduced several new policies. And one of these made me completely rethink my role as a computing teacher. And he stated that every teacher is a teacher of language. And he said, so this head teacher was Ollie Knight. He wrote a book called Creating Outstanding Classrooms, Whole School Approach. And when he said that every teacher is a teacher of language, he also said that mastery of a subject requires mastery of the language used in our subject. And I was always searching for a way to make content more memorable. And so here's a story I'm going to share with you that I share with my students. And I hope you share with your students as well. And it's a story about cache memory. And our students at GCSE and A-level need to know that cache memory is CPU memory, or it's part of the CPU, which stores frequently and recently used data. And it improves access speed when compared to accessing data from main memory. And to remember this, I'm going to tell you this story about cache. So the word cache actually was first used by French-Canadian fur trappers in the late 18th century. You can see them here. And these trappers, that was their actual name, they travel from their home to their hunting ground, and they'd cover hundreds of miles. I think in some reports they say thousands of miles by canoe, but definitely hundreds of miles by canoe. And because they travel so far on these hunts, I suppose you kind of see these trappers in the film The Revenant as well, don't you? But clearly, like, returning home to access provisions would take too long. So they would make these hiding places near to their trapping sites to store their provisions. And this is what they would look like. And what they would store in these hiding places, they'd store things like tools, weapons, food, and animal furs or pelts that they'd already processed. And these hiding places where they hid all these things close to their hunting site was actually called a cache. And the reason why it's called a cache is because the French verb cacher means to hide. So the same way that a fur trapper's cache was formed to enable faster access to frequently used provisions, so too is a CPU cache. And I use this story every time I teach cache memory, and hopefully it makes the term cache more memorable. And so I think that this story also required a bit of research, so I was digging deeper behind the etymology and the root of these words, and I encourage you to do that. And you might find that when you dig a bit deeper, you'll find that there's etymology in a lot of other words as well, such as binary, iteration, computer, bus, and polymorphism. And if you want to know a bit more about them, perhaps I'll drop those in the comments below the video. But yeah, all of those words, binary, iteration, computer, bus, polymorphism, they all have a certain etymology and a certain story behind them. I always tell these stories because I think it makes them a bit more memorable. So let's go back now to where we're with these semantic waves and examples of how we might help with semantic ways. So I've given you an example of stories and etymology. You could show a documentary. I think it's actually really useful to show documentaries. You might show them a bit of AlphaGo, or you might show them the TED Talk on filter bubbles, or on how algorithms have changed the world. And that, like, algorithms themselves are really abstract. But when you make them concrete, so when you do sorting algorithms with playing cards, or when you show a video of what an algorithm looks like as it sorts the data, that makes it more concrete. I think also video tutorials. So video tutorials are very simple and also very concrete. So particularly for programming, or when you're doing a certain skill in Photoshop, you might demo it, but you might as well record it as well. And then when students get stuck, they just go back to the video. And on my YouTube channel, there are literally thousands of YouTube videos with tutorials. So they're very concrete, and students just follow those along. So that would be making something more concrete. You might do concrete examples, case studies, and practicals. So that's like the bread and butter of science teachers, isn't it? So when you actually start introducing case studies, though, it begins to be a bit more complex, doesn't it? Because you start looking at a case study, an in-depth case study, such as Cambridge Analytica, or you might look at migration patterns in Brazil, in geography, for example. And already there's a lot of complexity and interconnections there. So not only is it complex and concrete, but also, so it's complex and concrete. And doing, you know, things like practical programming, that would definitely be in there as well. There's also this notion of I, we, you. So you would start off with worked examples, something that the teacher does, that's the I, and then the we, which is the joint construction. So that's something that you do together with the students. So you might code together or in pairs or with the teacher. And then eventually you're heading to independent practice. So essentially you're moving them from simple to complex and going from worked examples, joint construction, to independent practice. You're essentially getting them over to, this is the kind of where we want all our students to be, isn't it? And I'm going to give you an example of I, we, you now, because I think that's what I did when I did my conference session. So it wasn't just like all chat. We did actually have a look at this and try to plan our own lessons with I, we, you. This is all in a Google Drive, and I'll give you the link at the end of the video. It'll also be below, so you'll have access to the slides and also sample lessons with I, we, you. What we've got here then is, so we've got a do now. So this is the start of every lesson. We have a do now, which is going to be probably five questions, like quick five questions or five gaps, which test prior knowledge. So that's the start. And then what I would do is I would introduce them to how you might represent numbers in different ways. So 92, 4, 11, a tally, so like 5, and then 100. So writing those in words before introducing binary. You see that here. So this would be the actual lesson now. So this is the example that I would do. So I'd put 0101 in here. I don't have edit access because I'm logged into the wrong account. But you can download this. You can download all of the resources by just doing file download. So I'd put 0101 and I'd say, okay, there's a 1 below the 4. Well, actually, we would start with just a denary example, wouldn't we? And say that actually it's multiplication. So you've got 08, so you've got 0. 14, so it's a 4. 02s and 11, so it's 4 plus 1, which is 5. And then we do this one together, and then we go to independent practice. And once again, this red one is the I, and this one would be the we, and then they've got plenty of practice on their own. So that's like the I, we, you. And then this is the binary game that I spoke about. So this is another way of them getting concrete examples and plenty of practice there. I believe this is like a remake of the Cisco binary game, isn't it? Okay, so another one is logic gates. The lesson plan might be in here as well. I don't know if I include the lesson plan. Yeah, I did. So have a look at the lesson plan in your own time, but you'll see that I've got do now in here. That's like the start of every lesson. And we've got binary addition, overflow. And this is a completely different topic now. So because I'm trying to interleave lots of content, so I'm going to add in other topics to ensure that students aren't encountering that forgetting curve or improving on that forgetting curve. So we're looking at SQL on here. And then also I've interleaved something to do with CPU factors that affect CPU performance, like cores, clock speed, and cache. And then syntax errors as well. That's like a great do now. Five questions across five completely different topics. It's really going to stretch students and get them to think across a wide range of topics. I have a whole host of do nows as well. I think I can share those in a link. I've probably got, loads of those somewhere. Okay, so this is an example of IWU, so advanced logic exercise. So we would have already done logic. This isn't like the first thing that we do in logic. We would have told them what an AND gate is, an OR gate is, and a NOT gate. And this is like the last lesson in logic, I suppose. And so we're combining gates now, and we're introducing the. So this is the one that we do together. Sorry, this is the one that I do on the board. This is the one that we do together. And then there's lots of independent practice. These are way more complex than anything they'd see at GCSE and maybe even A level. And by the time they finish that lesson, I asked them, did you find that difficult? And they were like, yeah, it was fairly tricky. I was like, look, if you found that tricky and you still got like most of the answers right, then you're pleased to know that this is actually taken from like a first year electronics engineering lecture. So, and the link is there. Then they're really encouraged by that. If they can do this problem, they can do any GCSE problem. And I give this to my year 10s and 11s. Then, because we've done lots of abstract examples, we're just looking at gates, right? We then need to go concrete. So I've then said, an example might be a water pump being designed that only pumps water when the main switch A is on and there's water present in the system, sensor B. Draw the logic diagram. So they've then got like a real life scenario to apply that to. And then more concrete examples. So that's the I, this is the we, and this is the you. And then they eventually, this is more practice for them, more independent practice. And then we go more abstract. So then I've given them an essay about Moore's Law and linking the fact that Moore's Law is increasing, well, the number of transistors on a chip doubling every year. And asking them, like, what are the implications of that? Like, what is the impact of that on stakeholders, technology, ethics, and environment? And I would get them to plan it here and then to write the essay there. So we plan it as a we, I think, so joint again, and then we would do it all together. Actually, then it would be independent. So that is how I would use I, we, you, in terms of to create a semantic wave. Okay. Other things, so reading, tracing, annotating, and commenting. So this is for programming, I suppose. So by reading code, tracing it, and commenting your code, you're essentially going more abstract because you're saying, well, why did I use a for loop here instead of a while loop? Why did I decide to use this algorithm here? You might ask them different types of questions. So you might ask them a defined question, eventually explain and evaluate. And this is now going back up. So now we're generalizing and going back upwards into the abstract. So to complete the semantic wave, eventually we get them to evaluate the use of binary or the use of hexadecimal or evaluate the effect of glaciation on the landscape in Wales, for example. Or evaluate the ethics behind genetic engineering in biology. You would then give interleave questions, and we saw that in the do now earlier. So you would try to interleave as many, well, not as many topics as possible, but that Moore's Law question asked them to interleave things like factors affecting CPU with binary and logic gates, cheaper logic gates, for example. Yeah, so interleaving content is quite key in terms of what the cognitive science says in helping students learn. Eventually, then you would get them to hypothesize. So, what would happen, for example, to the Internet of Things as it grows? What would happen if you didn't have protocols or didn't have layers? What would happen if you just had solid state drives and no magnetic drives? So we're talking now. We're like right at the top end. So GCSE grade 9 or A star, really getting people to hypothesize and then getting them to write an 8 mark question. They should be able to essentially write an 8 mark question on any topic in the spec on any of those tier 3 keywords. And like Maton goes on to suggest that at the highest level of academic writing at university, when he looked at the highest scoring assignments, they also had semantic waves in them. So each paragraph would present a theory, have some concrete examples, and then relate back to the overarching theory. And these semantic waves would appear throughout the essay, and you'd see these semantic waves within paragraphs and within the essay. And he therefore encourages us to teach our students about semantic waves, is to say to our students, look, right now I'm going to go concrete, and then we're going to go abstract, and the reason why we're doing these semantic waves and how we might use them in our extended writing. And essentially, the end goal is for students to be comfortable to move anywhere within a subject. And remember the zone that we looked at the beginning of the video on this right-hand side here? That's where we need them to be at. And it's impossible to precisely predict what's going to come up on an exam. But what we definitely know is that if students can move from abstract to concrete throughout an extended 4, 8, or 20 mark, like high tariff question, you know, that's not going to be easy. But with plenty of practice and experience of semantic waves in the classroom, they should be able to bridge that gap and go from like high stakes reading to high stakes writing and write and perform at the highest level. Other examples I've put in unplugged here. So in the session, people came up with their own, in the conference session, people came up with their own strategy as well. I asked them, well, you know, like, what else do you do in the classroom? And people talked about unplugged. So yeah, of course, when you do a card sort for sorting algorithms, or I actually have a whole booklet of computing outdoors, so things you can do with computing outdoors on a field trip or for homework. Those are concrete. And then storyboards, like you might, they're quite simple ways of representing things in, say, IT and iMedia. You might storyboard something before you actually make something, or like visualization diagrams in iMedia, for example. And poetry, I may mention Adrian Tuff has a couple of books out which link computing with poetry. There's also learning games. I'm not the kind of teacher to, you know, put students on like a learning game or like Code Academy or whatever every single lesson, but actually sometimes I will use learning games and logic games because I think they're actually useful. I've given that IOU example. The lesson plan is in the folder, so I've talked about that already. Oh yeah, so what I did was I asked people to add to that previous slide, and we did a think pair share, tackling the most difficult words in the spec. So what we actually looked at was like, I would advise you to go back to this slide and your tier three keywords that you made easy earlier, and think about what technique you would use to teach each of those tier three keywords. Like, how would you teach binary? How would you teach cache? How would you teach the fetch, decode, and execute cycle? How would you teach wireless networks? Which strategies would you use in here to do that? And over the year or over a unit, I would imagine you'd probably use all of these for each unit to get a complete picture. What we did next then is I asked us to put into this table like where these different things belonged. So another lens was looking at like different types of knowledge. So I said these tier three keywords, like which of these are process driven? Because what I suggested was that anything that is process driven, so things like doing binary conversions or programming, you essentially have to use I, we, you for that. You do it, they do it, and then they do it, you know, in pairs or in a group or with you, and then that they have to do it independently. So I, we, you is absolutely key for process-driven things. So in French, you might have like conjugating ER verbs, or like in like, I don't know, the past participle of verbs. That is classic I, we, you, this red section here. So I would argue that anything that is process-driven, so what people call, they might call skills or procedural knowledge, I would use I, we, you. And then what we might consider more content-driven, like declarative knowledge, or just knowledge, I suppose, I think that takes different techniques. Like, you can't really do I, we, you for declarative knowledge. That's not going to really work, is it? So for declarative knowledge, I think it would be things like using similes, analogy, metaphors, mnemonics, showing a documentary, define, explain, evaluate, giving lots of concrete examples, case studies. Whereas on the process-driven, I might put in things like practicals, video tutorials. Yeah, so I would have really think about not only how are you going to teach each of those tier three keywords and each of those concepts, but what techniques are effective for process-driven things in the spec, and what techniques are useful for content-driven, so things which are more knowledge-based, declarative knowledge-based. So hopefully we've talked about how we essentially need to get our learners from high-stakes reading to high-stakes writing. And actually, the answer to how do we bridge that gap, the semantic gap, maybe Carl Matton offers the answers in these semantic waves. And I highly encourage you to have a look at his other works on legitimation code theory. I'm still going through that myself, to be honest. And yeah, I think we covered this already. Further reading for semantic waves, there's this video here. I've got a link to all these slides, so you could just click on the links. There's the blog here by DigiTeacher. I think he's based in South Africa. And then there's this journal article by Matton as well. Here's that DigiTeacher guy. Let me just go to that website, because I seem to remember reading it. And that's what really got me onto semantic waves in the first place. And I think it happened that quite a few people were looking at this at the same time. I think like Professor Paul Curzon was also looking at this. But this teacher, Dorian Love, who is actually on Twitter, I follow him on Twitter, has been writing about this since like 29th of March 2018. So he's been looking at this for like 2 or 3 years. And he looked at these semantic waves. So this is what got me first started, and then what really made me think more deeply about computing. This was probably the starting point for me, and that's a great blog to dip into, I would say. Other further reading for teaching and learning, I've got all these titles here. Teach Like a Champion is, for me, it's such an iconic text for how to like run a classroom. Some people don't like it. Like, some people think it's like a bit oppressive. But you know, like, actually, having like spoken to Doug in the past, and when you see all his videos, it is all about like his whole movement is about like social mobility. And being able to essentially teach knowledge and skills in the most efficient way and learning from like the best teachers around the world. And it's full of video clips as well. I believe Teach Like a Champion 3.0 is like in the process of being written. Dylan William is obviously very influential from his work on formative assessment and the black box, as he says. Bringing Words to Life by Beck. So this was a really important book because it teaches you more about etymology and how actually learning more about language and how students acquire language is key to success in any subject. So I hope there are people watching this who are not computer science teachers and who have not been completely put off by the bit of computing theory that I've presented there. Engelmann and Cunning's Theory of Instruction is a really difficult read, but it's essentially lots of examples and thoughts on direct instruction. I laugh about it because it's so difficult to digest, but it's something I dip into and out of. Ollie Knight and David Benson's book, Creating Outstanding Classrooms, that is essentially what got me first started on my journey into looking at effective classroom, being more effective in the classroom, and eventually writing my book, Teaching Computing in Secondary Schools, which is, you know, research-based. It's based on like the latest cognitive science. And yeah, I think if you're into that, then How We Learn is a great primer for that as well. I have on my blog a list of other books which you probably want to check out. So on my blog, there's this post, What Every Teacher Training Program Should Teach, which I wrote about a year ago. And at the end, you can see that I've got this diagram and also the books that I would recommend. Can I open that in a new tab? Does that work? So we can see them nice and big. Yeah, Hidden Lives of Learners, another classic. It was written by Graham Nuttall in New Zealand, where he did an ethnographic study recording conversations in the classroom. And he's the one who really pioneered the concept about how students essentially need to encounter a topic three times in three different ways to actually understand it. So for that to go to long-term memory. And we don't know why that is. And we think that maybe it's to do with evolution. So maybe it's to do with the fact that the brain is deliberately designed to filter out irrelevant information. But by the time we've encountered it a third time in a different way, then it goes to long-term memory. That neural pathway is solid for most of us. And maybe that's something to do. Semantic waves has to play there as well. Like by presenting a concept in abstract, concrete, back to abstract, that's three different ways already, isn't it? An Ethic of Excellence is brilliant in terms of projects and how you get students to think about drafting, redrafting. Make It Stick is kind of like a more in-depth and why students don't like school. Both of these are, you know, solid books for cognitive science. If you just want an intro, then I suppose read How We Learn if you find that interesting. And these two books are a bit heavier, but better. The Motivation Breakthrough. I started reading that. I think it's really good. It talks about students with special educational needs and students who might not be able to access education. And maybe even this concept that behavior, or poor behavior, is communication. So all behavior is communication. Someone's acting up in your classroom. Well, maybe they're just trying to communicate something and trying to understand what that is. The End of Average, I think, is really important because it teaches us that there's no average child. There's no what works for the average works for no one, actually. So we need to like make everything like quite bespoke and think about the individual learners and the individual context. Some people just say that that's nonsense, that actually context is irrelevant. Well, you know, having taught for like 14, 15 years in like five different schools, I can tell you the context is important. What works in one school's not necessarily going to work exactly the same in another school. Why We Sleep, probably the most important book I've ever read. I'll leave it at that. Start with why. You see that even in this presentation, I start with why. It's quite important. Clever Lands is a fascinating book by Lucy Crean about different education systems around the world. Sarah Jane Blakemore, fascinating research into how the teenage brain works. Legacy is more a book on culture. Steve Peters' book on mind management is about, I suppose, like how we manage our emotions and maybe even like thinking fast and slow, that kind of thing. The Art of Learning I love because it's like a more of an anecdotal way into learning and the way that Josh Waits can learn in certain ways. And yeah, I think the way he articulates the learning process both in chess and martial arts, I think there is some transferability there. People say there's no transferability in like business books or in learning books, but I actually think that it's just a good read. If you are involved in training other teachers, so if you're a head of department or you're a mentor, Get Better Faster is an amazing program. When I was an assistant head, we basically ran the whole teaching and learning on Get Better Faster and Doug Lamov's Teach Like a Champion 2.0 as well. I'm shocked at that. Oh yeah, it's up here. Teach Like a Champion 2.0 is here. Yeah, so we basically ran the whole program on these two. And then that really hard to digest book by Engelman and Carney is in there as well. Anything else worth checking out on the blog? I mean, have a look at this. Oh, I probably want to go back to this. So yeah, there's so much I could talk about. I've written about most of this, but like modeling. So this morning, actually, I had someone message me on Twitter asking about modeling. And I'd say that like IWU is bread and butter in terms of modeling. We need to scaffold. We need to use a visualizer or classroom management software to do that when you're showing things. A dual coding. So by having pictures next to text and having lots of concrete examples. Mixed examples, so examples of different qualities, like a bad example, a middle mark band and a top mark band, that is quite important. And I think it is... who's the guy who did that? Royce. Sadler Royce did this great work on like mixed examples and how we need to use mixed examples. And these large functional wall displays, you'll see I've got loads of those on my website here. So if you go to mrlearning.com, go on to resources. And actually just go straight to freebies. So I do sell physical resources, but I'm not really here to push that. The main thing I want to show you is that most of my resources I give away for free. So all the physical resources are there, just in case you don't have access to a printer or you like to have paper copies. You can get those from here or from Amazon. But actually, all of them I give away for free. So that Computing Outdoors book with like Unplugged Computing is in here. So lots of ways of teaching computing unplugged and outdoors. You can do it in teams or you can do it individually. That's a great set of missions and debriefings in there. But yeah, large functional wall displays. So these things I have in my classroom and they're like, they take up half the classroom, I'd say. Like literally a whole wall is this. And then these little icons are cut out and use them to demonstrate how like things are loaded from like RAM, from secondary storage into RAM and then into virtual memory, literally physically move them into virtual memory when RAM is full. So I use those as like working wall display. And yeah, there's like a whole load of stuff in here, like computer science coloring book. I mean, these A3 classroom displays, I'd say A3 or A2 is minimum in any classroom. If you're going to use A3 displays in a classroom, you're going to have to print them 3 or 4 times because you're going to have to replicate the same display 4 times around the room so everyone can see it. So the anatomy of a data packet. This one actually we use and we cut out and send it around the room. Classes. And these are made by Peter Kemp, I believe, and he made them available Creative Commons. I encourage us all to make things available Creative Commons because like that way we all just get better a lot faster, to borrow Paul Van Rick Santoro's this is another one of Peter Kemp's, I think. This one's possibly mine, yeah. Programming constructs, like sequence selection, iteration. So I'm trying to use dual coding there throughout. What else is there to talk about? Behavior assessment. These are kind of like in my book, retrieval practice. Yeah, retrieval practice is key. If you're not doing like a do now, like quick fire 5 do nows, like 5 questions at the beginning of every lesson, then I would recommend you do that because that's one way to get students to interleave and practice, like space practice, using online platforms like Quizlet. Some people use Educate for other subjects, Seneca. I love Quizlet. I've written my own sets on that. And the great thing about Quizlet, I mean, this is like complete separate. I didn't really talk about this in my conference, but I thought whilst I'm here, I might as well just go for everything right that I do as a teacher. So I have my class here. And say, for example, my GCSE computer science class, I can go in here and look at this year 10 Feb 2021 set, and I can go to progress. We subscribe to this. I can't remember how much it is a year, but it's cheap. It's like £30 to £100 a year. And for that, I can see when students have taken a test and what their score is. I actually don't care about the score because the testing program, the way it works is the platform is that for the questions that they get wrong, they get those questions more often, and the questions that they get right, they get those less often. So it's pure like interleaving, spacing, forgetting curve, all of that built in. And the questions I wrote myself, but you can just, I suppose, you can get hold of my sets anyway. So in here, I can see that Adam 21740 got 65%, but I'm actually not that bothered about that. I don't really care what he got in the test. It's more that he's actually doing the test at a certain time. And eventually, I'm telling them to aim for 90% because that allows for some typos and spelling errors. And if they can get 90 or 100% on these tests, then effectively they're going to get a grade 7 or above in their exam, pretty much guaranteed. I don't know anyone who's got like 90 and 100% on these tests frequently and then got less than that. So I combine them all into this master set. Hey, where's the master set gone? Did I not put that up yet? Maybe I haven't put it up yet because they're like my year 10 class. Where am I? Year 11 class? Here. So they have the master set. So 369 terms. Starts off with, I get them on learn. I tell them to take a test first. And then they go on to learn. And it asks them the question. And then it gives them feedback on it. It's brilliant. I mean, the free version works just as well. It's just you can't tell when they've taken a test. So you actually have to physically make sure they're doing it, but during remote lockdown and for homework we can't do that. Tests are great. There are pictures in there. I think I wrote most of these questions myself, or I adapted them based on someone else. Actually, someone on Facebook wrote them and then I adapted them. Yeah, pretty good. Anything else? Let's just go back to here. This is turning into like one long tutorial. I hope I press record. Imagine if I go here and it's not actually recording. Thank goodness it's recording. Knowledge. So yeah, different types of knowledge. If the holy grail or the end point is independent practice, and everything leads to that. Essentially, if your students can do things independently, then you've won, right? Not that's like a bit finite, isn't it? But eventually, if they can do anything independently, you can say, okay, yeah, they've learned it. They can do it independently. Okay. So, in terms of me, then you can follow me on Twitter, Mr. Lau Learning. You're obviously on this YouTube video anyway, but it's Mr. Lau Test and my website, Mr. Lau Learning. There are physical resources that you can buy, all free. They're pretty much all free as well. There as well. And then you can email me if you've got any questions about this. And then lastly, the slides and resources are available here, bit.do/CAS2020WLAU. I hope that's been useful and a decent introduction into semantic waves, particularly for computing teachers, but also for anyone from other subjects as well. I'll leave it there, and I think that is all. Any questions, feel free to contact me here or pop them in the YouTube comments or on Twitter. I'm fairly active on social media. And I hope you have a lovely day and that this was useful to you all.